Okay, I'm going to call this special work session of December the 4th to order. And if you'll notice on the title tonight for the work session, it's discussion regarding use of roundabouts in transportation networks. So that should highlight to you that this is more of a high-level discussion about how roundabouts are used and how we so we can better understand. And I know there's many people in the audience that have very specific questions, and some of them may even be down in the weeds a little bit. And I don't want us to get down in the weeds tonight. So I do have a few speakers cards, and I'll make a decision on those as we get toward the end of the session. And I noticed that our topic also, another way to mention it, is exploring the benefits of modern roundabouts. So, you know, we have the board here tonight, and we're going to listen intently. And I'm going to let Paul Hosen introduce our consultant. And also, I would like to for him to be able to go through his entire presentation before we start asking questions. So you have pen and paper, and you can write down your questions that you want to ask at the end. So, Paul, please.
So as we look forward to moving forward with new roundabouts in our community, one thing that was requested is that we do more public education and present on roundabouts to help educate everybody. And so with us today is Mark Lenters with Kimley Horn & Associate, and he is our roundabout expert that's helping on the job and also agreed to come in and do a general presentation on roundabouts to help educate those interested. So I'm going to turn it over to Mark to go through his presentation.
Would you like to sit down and do it, Mark?
No, I've been sitting for a few hours, so if you don't mind.
Oh, it's, yeah. Hey, no, we want you to be comfortable.
I can see the audience and collect some of the body language. When I get long-winded, I look around and maybe I just...
If I kind of start doing this,
yeah,
my neck's not itching.
Yeah. My hosts is Volkert. You can see their name on the slide. They've suggested I come to work with you on this. I don't know if we can call this roundabout high noon, but every agency should do this kind of a meeting. You know, in order to reap the benefits of roundabouts, there's a lift. And when you do multi-lane roundabouts, you have to work hard at the education. There's no pretending about that. I've been doing roundabouts for about 20 years now, in maybe 20 different states. And states that have, you know, embarked on roundabouts and kind of a bottom-up where they build single lanes, and that's their training wheels, and they collect that experience, it takes longer for them to reach up to get some of the higher congestion and higher safety problems. States like Colorado, where it was top down, they solved their worst congestion and their worst safety problems first, and they discovered that roundabouts trickle down. They still needed education, though. You know, the success of any traffic scheme in our textbook tells us there's two things. It's the quality of the design, you know, which we've got a good team here to work on the quality of the design, but it's also the adaptability of the driver. And as a community, we haven't been as astute on that. And even when we try to push that, typically the money follows the project. And we do outreach for the project, but there isn't anything stitching together outreach from project to project. So agencies that are willing to step into the ring and get the benefits of roundabouts, they have to be willing to do the education. So that I want to say that as an opener. So we'll move through some slides. So why have roundabouts become an attractive choice? I'm going to try and show you pros and cons. It's mostly good news, but there are times when it can get messy, and we'll talk about that too. So the increased safety, reduced injury crash frequency, that's what really led my career in that path. I do a lot of safety audit type work, and at signalized intersections, the toolbox was just too shallow. We could not find good countermeasures for injury crashes at traffic signals. So I discovered roundabouts about 20 years ago when they were just getting started here, and I just ended up going in that direction full time because I just see, you know, we're saving lives. I'm not a doctor, but after 500 roundabouts, I think we're doing pretty good at preserving life and reducing injuries. Operational efficiency is something you experience every day. Crashes occur infrequently, but we all know congestion, and roundabouts are excellent for that. So But geometry can be difficult when you get skewed intersections or more than five legs, and they're very suitable for more than four legs, five-leg intersections. Wide nodes, narrow roads was a term that my predecessor, Leif Auerstein, coined. And it's this idea that if you have a thoroughfare plan and you think that some of these roads are going to need six lanes, when you use roundabouts on the arterial intersections, you can generally save one lane in each direction. So if you think you need six, you can probably get away with four plus roundabouts at the intersections. Where does congestion occur? The congestion occurs at the intersections. So when we can treat the intersection with something that can mitigate congestion, then the mid-blocks don't need the extra lanes. Safer for pedestrians, but not everybody feels that way. The statistics show us that, but not everybody feels safe when they cross a roundabout, and we'll go into that in detail. Reduced life cycle costs. Roundabouts can be more expensive in some cases. Georgia DOT, where I'm in an advisory role, they're looking at cost reduction on roundabouts, trying to do them with less safety money, less congestion relief money. And the savings in societal crash reduction, you know, injuries, doctors, you know, claims, that's not something that comes back to you as an agency. So we think it's the conscionable thing to do. It's the responsible thing to do, but it does sometimes cost more. And then the quality of life. We've seen so many instances where roundabouts have improved business opportunity for communities, and I have a bit of drone video coming up to show examples of that from around the country. You know, harmonizing transportation is a very popular thing. We want to complete streets and give a balance between pedestrians, bicycles, and vehicular traffic, and roundabouts tend to be the nexus of that. They bring all that together and make it possible to have good capacity and still uphold safety. So we'll launch into it. So across the U.S., by about 2013, and you know, the densification of dots on these maps of the states, it's just getting thicker in many places. You can see Tennessee kind of in the middle there, and there's only a couple of roundabouts. Chattanooga's, I think, 10 or 15 now. They get on the news every once in a while, and they get the pros and cons. And again, it's often education. Historical concerns. So these are the kinds of things that agencies have been dealing with. This research report from roughly 1998 was the early days of roundabouts, and those concerns still exist today. They're not sure they're safe. Are they in the design guidelines for engineers? What about liability? How do we deal with that? What about efficiency? Do they work efficiently enough? Can they work with traffic signals nearby? And will drivers get used to them? Look at that. That's the highest and the biggest concern. Will drivers understand them? So some of the benefits. The top right corner is a traffic control prior to roundabouts. When it signals, we can reduce injuries almost 80%. And that statistic's been strong for about 15 years now. I've worked with a number of states to do before and after studies, Michigan, Wisconsin, Illinois, and we're seeing those statistics really strong across the country. 80% reduction in injuries when you convert a traffic signal control to a modern roundabout. Now, the property damage reduction is not as encouraging. In fact, in some cases, fender benders, you know, are about the same as the traffic signal, or they can actually go up. And that's a function of design and driver education. But it's sobering to see that. Still, we see the injury reduction as being a really popular reason to use roundabouts. Always stops, the conversions are a little less favorable. And two-way stops, it's very favorable. You know, when you have a side street that can't get out, the roundabout resolves that conflict problem. In the lower right corner, pedestrians, big focus, complete streets. You know, we have a shrinking population. I'm a baby boomer, and there aren't as many kids coming up to pay for my retirement. So we have to watch. And zero, you know, road to zero, every state, every agency wants to reduce injuries related to vehicles and pedestrians and transit and so on. And you can see that at higher speeds, the chances of death are fairly certain at 40 miles per hour and above. And down in the range where roundabouts live, at the 20 to 30 miles per hour, the chances of death are very, very small, which is, again, very encouraging. So that doesn't mean pedestrians feel safer at roundabouts, but in fact they are, even though they don't feel that way. So what is a modern roundabout? Now, if anyone's lived around the country, you'll have experiences with circular intersections that that are varied. And we all know about traffic calming in neighborhoods. You know, people become prisoners of their own traffic calming devices, and that became a bit of an issue. But the neighborhood traffic circle was really a way of, you know, cutting speed and reducing infiltration in neighborhoods. It's not very sophisticated in the way it alternates the flow of traffic. The traffic circle in the top right corner is really about placemaking. You know, it's the center of a village. In Georgia, they've got a lot of squares. And there's parking around the center. There's, you know, the county courthouse is in the middle of the intersection. And I wouldn't want to convert those to modern roundabouts because there's so much history and placemaking there. And maybe the traffic is a bit frictionless, but they get through. Now, the one on the left, the far top left, is a rotary. And that was an invention from about the 30s and 40s. And they've all but disappeared in places like maybe a couple in New Jersey and maybe one or two on the West Coast. And they're being converted to modern roundabouts. And I had the privilege of working on several very high-volume rotary conversions. And the results were really striking. Like, we got 60% crash reductions. We got, you know, half-mile queues down to hundreds of feet, and really, really pleased with the results. And then pedestrians and bikes could get through more comfortably because we cut speeds down. So there, none of those are modern roundabouts. Let's look at what a modern roundabout is. Oh, and this is also not a modern roundabout. This is over in California, and it's, again, one of the last few, and you'll just watch the vehicle ballet occur. And they're weaving, and the reason they're weaving close to exits is because the circle's too large. And that means speeds are high. You can see trucks turning over. And traffic will just kind of weave. In a minute, there'll just be this big interaction where people are forcing their way in, making it really difficult to get around. That's not how a modern roundabout operates. So we want to clear that up, because there might be people who say, well, I've been to Long Beach, California, and if you're going to build that, I'm moving away. And that's not what we're going to propose, and that's not what we're building elsewhere in the country. So what is a modern roundabout? The red lines on the diagram show all the different movements from one entry, the right through and left, and the U-turn. U-turns can be made more easily because the circle's larger, trucks can get around. But it's essentially a compact circular intersection. Traffic flows counterclockwise. Go ahead. There's our arrows. It has speed control, entering traffic yields. That's the big thing. Some of the old rotaries and traffic circles, traffic in the circle stopped for traffic entering the circle, which is the opposite of what the modern roundabout is. The modern roundabout is, once you're in the circle, you have the priority, the right of way. Entering traffic must yield. Doesn't always. And sometimes they'll find a gap that almost looks like it's going to be a crash, but they get in. In places like England, France, Australia, they've got it all sorted out, they say, and they don't have a lot of crash incidents. But it feels kind of unnerving, you know, when someone just kind of floats in. But they have speed control. That's another big thing for pedestrians. And in order to get the right-of-way in the circle, the inner traffic has to slow down. And so we put in what's called geometric speed control. So a bit of left offset of the entry and some deflection on the entry, so you get geometric speed control. They're channelized entries. And they're designed to slow vehicle speeds. When you get the entry speeds down to about 20 to 25, there's a pretty good chance the entering driver will yield, because they'll see the sign on the right that says yield, and there's a bit of a conscience thing. That's becoming more of a stretch these days as drivers get too relaxed about rules of the road, but we're still seeing good results. So here's a roundabout with, and I put in the caption, comparable to Mallory Liberty Pike. So this is carrying about 30, 35,000 cars per day. This is just a little bit off the peak hour. There'll be a little more of a clip later on, but you can see that traffic's moving through anywhere from 15 to 20, 25 miles per hour. The trucks sometimes take up all of the lane and then some, and people stay away from the trucks, and the truck drivers are taught to do that. So you can see that there's a lot of traffic in the circle. There's no lost time. The next time you pull up to a traffic signal, and you're waiting, and you look in the intersection, and there's no one in the intersection, we call that lost capacity. 100% of the capacity is lost while that space is empty. When you watch the roundabout, that space is often quite full of traffic. That's a very good thing. Okay. So what are the physical features? This one's in North Carolina. The circulatory roadway, that's the traveled way. You know, throughs, lefts, rights. The splitter island divides opposing flows. It helps with some of the speed control. The exit, We need an exit if we have an entry. We have to be able to get traffic out of the circle. And then the entry side where we put in geometric speed control, then there'll be a truck apron and a central island, splitter island, central island. That ring of concrete or interlocking brick around the central island that's landscaped, we call that a truck apron. And it helps for the very large vehicles, oversized vehicles that need more swept path to make the turn. They have a little extra space. There's a bit of a lip or an apron, you know, edge on it. It's 3 to 4 inches tall, and it discourages all but the tallest SUVs with big tires. And once in a while, they'll go through and over-track it. But it's pretty, it's infrequent. So it's intended to help with the speed control, and it's for oversized trucks. What kind of crashes do we see at roundabouts compared to other intersections? Well, the closing speed of an angle crash is, a function of the approach speeds. And if both cars are doing 45 or 50, when they collide, they tend to spin, and there's a lot of physics involved that results in injury, even with airbags and side airbags. The left turn collision is almost an opposing head-on collision, and that, again, can be lethal or certainly injurious. The roundabout has the side swipe. It's a modified T-bone. It's a lower speed crash, typically. It's a glancing blow. We don't need helicopter pads for extrication of victims. We get asked that sometimes. Where's the helicopter going to land? And you don't need them. So because the injuries are very slight, as compared to what's in the photo. And I took the photo on the top. The one on the bottom, I wouldn't want to be there. There's probably severe injuries and the jaws of life. So when we look at comparing signals to roundabouts, and it's important, I think, to have a stepping off point. We all understand signals. It's habit formed. We grew up with them. So what do we have? And do we really like what we have? They have high speeds. Well, that's nice when it's green and I have the right of way. But what if someone doesn't stop from the other direction? The short response time at signals, even though it's habit formed, we have to react pretty quickly to something that's going wrong. The crashes have higher energy involvement. They tend to be less forgiving. It's surprisingly, although we understand signals, they are complex. The sources of information to the driver are multiple, and we're processing them. And there's this thing called the dilemma zone on the intersection approaches, where you're committed to run through on the amber, or the functional area of the intersection where you have to make a choice. And once you're committed, you're going through at speed. Wide visual scans are required. You have to be able to see pedestrians, opposing traffic, turning traffic, and then it's coming from multiple directions. So whether we realize it or not, traffic signals are fairly complex. And when they fail, it's usually without warning. And we try not to design infrastructure to fail without warning. On the right-hand side, we can see roundabouts of low speed, low energy. They tend to be more forgiving. There's an uncertainty, in the complexity, and it's called gap seeking. Am I going to get a gap? Will the driver give me a gap? And that's complex. If you're an older driver, gap seeking is not an easy thing to do. So that takes time, practice, and education. There are narrow visual scans. Traffic comes from one direction, your left. And in the pedestrian crosswalk, traffic comes from one direction and at lower speeds. So there's some positive things to be said, but as I say, gap seeking can be complicated. So I won't go into the details, but we have an uncontested safety history with injury reduction statistics on roundabouts. And I just pulled this out this morning from some research reports. 20 years of safety statistics are telling us the same thing over and over again, that we're getting safety benefits from converting signals and stop control to roundabouts, both safer for peds and pedestrians and for vehicular traffic. So that's the good news. So we want to compare traffic operations throughput. Just click on that lower left corner of the black slide. There it comes. So these two slides are simulations that both intersections are carrying the same level of traffic, and you'll see sometimes the same color of vehicle, and you'll watch them come up. In the case of a stop bar, there's the blue truck on the, I'm going to try and get my laser pointer going here. So there goes the truck through, and he's still sitting at the stop bar. So what we tend to see at signals is bunching. And we'd say, well, that roundabout's not carrying very much traffic because, look, there's no queuing. There's no, well, it's carrying the same amount of traffic. It just doesn't have to stop. It gets through. And, the traffic will get its turn over here on the right. And when they do, and if they can all arrive on the green, it's ideal. We love that. Give everybody the green, and they come through on the green, like that car in the curb lane. He's just sweeping through. That's ideal. But that sometimes only happens 50% of the time. And the other 50% of the time, we have to stop. And the roundabout just keeps flowing. And it at night, you don't have to wait to actuate the signal. You just go in and find a gap. So they tend to have fewer stops, better air quality, and less idling. And we're trying to get all those things these days. Roundabouts and driveway access. I think that was a question that arose. This is a little bit more about commercial development, because you've got a complex of three intersections that were converted from traffic signals to roundabouts. That happens to be in Wisconsin. There's several of these around the country. This one's probably 8 or 9 years old. After these were installed, the commercial development invested about $15 million in renovations and upgrades, and it really enriched the area. And prior to that, it was a fairly sterile environment because access was difficult. Speeds are lower, pedestrians can move from one side of the street to the other, and it has higher capacity. The queues from the intersections, this one in particular, the larger one, and this is again about the same volume of traffic as Mallory Lane and Liberty, the queues used to back way up in all directions, so they covered all these driveways to the fast food and the plaza, and it made it difficult to get in and out of those developments. So there's still a little bit of congestion, but they don't wait as long. So on the left slide, the before condition, a fairly sterile intersection area in terms of landscape, lots of pavement. But they've added in this feature, and they can put some landscape design and beautify it, and it tends to be a placemaking feature. Trucks and roundabouts, that's a common question. We go to public meetings and a truck driver shows up and they don't think their truck will fit. And this is again a multi-lane that's comparable to what you're contemplating on Liberty Pike, and you'll see the truck driver's probably waiting a little longer than he needs to. And once he does go, he effectively creates his own gap. And they'll straddle lanes, and the car behind, they'll give way to the truck in behind, and you'll see he'll take it, get all the way through. When there's a gap, they just roll right through, and they don't use the Jake brakes, and they don't make as much noise and spew as much, discharge as much pollutants. And they're straddling lanes. And that's what the truck driver training facilities we've consulted with around the country, that's how they try to encourage the driver not to let the traffic in on the right-hand side where they can't see them in the blind spot. And this one is coming from the other direction. So, roundabouts next to schools. This is a site where we did some education, worked with the school, and it's a large high school, and just when this one was opening, and it's, again, very high volume, two four-lane roads, that we met with the pedestrians as they came out of the school. We encouraged them to learn to cross the roundabout assertively as a pedestrian. And that doesn't mean holding traffic up, but we encouraged them to raise their hand and essentially point their intention to cross. And a more assertive pedestrian, as it turned out, encouraged drivers to stop. It was a passive form, but it worked quite effectively. And we borrowed the idea actually from Fort Lauderdale, Florida, where they have problems with seniors getting across at traffic signals. And so right turns on red, they have to train the seniors to think that they're going to cross. And just because the walk signal says it's safe to go, that doesn't mean they can get across at the signal. So the idea of point and walk, we try to associate that with roundabouts, and it's become quite effective. So working with young drivers, this is a module that it's painter's tape, it's cones, it's some signs and some cue cards, and the 10th grade about to drive students are this is plugged into their civics class, and the kids even design a video and educate themselves, and it becomes a bit of a fun activity, and they're taught how to walk, bike, and drive as though they're a truck or a car going through the roundabout, and they learn a great deal. Now, right next to the roundabout, we tape a traffic signal, and you can see the signal in the background here, and the students are sitting waiting. So there'll be platoons of students lining up waiting for the green while this roundabout flow is just continuing to go. And so the kids are asked to respond, afterwards. Well, they say, yeah, this is a bit complicated to figure out a gap, but we get it, and they take it home and train their parents. That's how we got the recycling. My kids brought home recycling. And they told me to put this thing in that box. And I got it. So the pedestrian safety is a big consideration. We've seen good reductions in pedestrian-related crashes at intersections. They're infrequent to begin with, but when they do occur, there's usually severe injury involved, especially at traffic signals. Most of us might know somebody that's been involved in a vehicle crash as a pedestrian, and usually there's a long rehabilitation period. So we've seen reductions of close to 90% because of lower speeds. There's fewer opportunities for the crash to occur. The pedestrian awareness is higher. That's interesting. You know, we don't feel as safe at the roundabout, but in fact we are, because we're more assertive and behaving assertively. You'll interact with the driver better than if you just, you know, blindly step out and assume that the walk signal is a safe passage. It doesn't always guarantee a safe passage. So comparing crossing risks, the left side is the intersection at Mallory Lane and Liberty Pike, and there's a long crossing there on the high school side. It's 80 feet, and you have to cross it all at one time. And there's traffic coming from three directions, potentially, or four. If you count the directions that would fail to stop for the red light, which is the north-south direction, the left turns can still occur and the right turns can still occur. So the pedestrian has a lot of things to consider, and it's not safe to assume that the walk signal is going to create a passageway. On the right-hand side is a roundabout that's appropriate for that level of traffic. There are two 26-foot crossings, which is about two 13-foot lanes. There's a refuge in the center. The pedestrian can stop, a bicycle, a stroller, a trailer bike, a wheelchair. They can rest, and then they are only looking in one direction for traffic approaching at about 20 to 25 miles per hour compared to the speeds in the traffic signal. So if I knew very little about, you know, the safety statistics, I would just look at the right diagram and I'd say, well, inherently I think that's going to be a safer intersection because speeds are lower, it's a shorter crossing, and traffic's only coming from one direction. That's in my interest. Except I still have to be assertive and try and get a gap from the driver and wait for the driver to yield. So the crossing at the roundabout, we're really short of volunteers, so I do this kind of stuff from time to time. And this is now about 8 or 9 years old, and this is the point and walk idea. Wait for a gap, eye contact with the driver, keep the hand raised, get to the refuge, look in the other direction, raise the hand, watch the driver stop. You know, when we did some before and after studies, without raising the hand, we had about 40% of the drivers would stop for the pedestrian at the roundabout crosswalk. And in some studies, we got 80 to 100% of the drivers recognizing the pedestrian. So it's a low-cost solution to get the pedestrian to raise their hand. It's not more signals. It's an assertive pedestrian that's behaving responsibly in the crosswalk. Now, that's not for younger children. Under the age of 12, we can't judge the speed of traffic. We've all forgotten that. But in the next slide, we'll see right here. So this is a crosswalk on a single lane roundabout. It's on a corridor with three schools, a high school, a middle school, and an elementary school. In the far side of the video, you'll see here's the platoon of pedestrians. And this one happens to have two crossing guards, but it only really needs one. This guard could cross in the peak direction, go back and pick up the next platoon, cross in the peak direction. But notice what's about to happen here. If you can see that youngster, he's on a bicycle, he's dropped his knapsack. Now, if that was a traffic signal, it's about to change, and he's still in the crosswalk. So the crossing guard helps, he's on his way, he gets his bag, he's still in the crosswalk, and he has priority, he has the right of way. That's not something we should take for granted, and everyone is waiting for that pedestrian. So there's safety. Driver and pedestrian awareness, again, it's important that the pedestrian understand the expectations of the driver and the driver understand the pedestrian. When we don't have a match between those two expectations, we have a potential for safety problems. So sometimes adding more devices does not improve safety. They widen the gap between expectations. And so I'm not a big fan of more devices. But drivers do run red, and so we take for granted that the signal is giving us a walk, and we still see right turns on red. Go ahead. The yield rule encourages pedestrians to make sure motorists see them before crossing. And there's no guaranteed stop condition at an intersection, so they need to pay attention to each other. Again, for children under the age of 12, when that's kind of a cutoff where, you know, visual depth perception, speed perception is not good, they need an adult guard. And that's true even at traffic signals. So we have additional devices. You know, we want to really raise the awareness for the driver. There's flashing beacons. There's different varieties of these. Some are round, some are square, some are LED. They're ground mounted to the right and to the left, and they involve push button, and the pedestrian can see. And then on the central island, or on the splitter island, I should say, on the approach, we'll have this ground mounted sign. And there's a variety of additional things in the toolbox that agencies can use. I'm not saying that this is what you have to do, but it's one or two things that you have access to. And then education, I'm gonna kind of finish with that. Local education is needed. So in these brochures, and you know, not to zoom in on them, but you can see that there's sometimes the vehicle conflicts where the driver doesn't choose the correct lane. So we've got things like this: choose your lane before you get in the circle, and then you won't have to change lanes to get out. And then, you know, what directions do I have, what choices? Well, from the left turn, you can make a left lane, you make a left turn or through movement, or a U-turn. From the right lane, you make a through movement or right turn. And most conventional two-lane roundabouts have that simple left lane, left turns, right lane, throughs and rights. And as long as we can get that point across, then people won't make lane changes like the left diagram shows. So we work with law enforcement, the schools, seniors. You know, this is one of these things that has to be caught in 1,000 touches, and there we have it in a little more detail. The three E's of traffic management will make for a successful traffic scheme. The engineering side, we've after 20 years, we think we can design roundabouts pretty good. The education is absolutely necessary, and enforcement is there to encourage it and support it. So, and that's about it. Thanks for listening and taking the time.
Yeah, go ahead. Go ahead. No.
My thing was entries to business. Did you show that?
Are you Alderman Peterson?
Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm going to let you go ahead. You
yeah, please. Do.
You're to my left. Yeah. So.
Did you talk to the business?
No, I miss for you when you come out of a roundabout to go into a business that's close by. Mm-hmm. Were there any issues, or can you talk about any issues with that?
So there's two.
And how does the businesses feel about roundabout right in their backyard?
There's two talking points with the business considerations. It's the proximity of access to the circle, and we can generally get access to development closer to the intersection when we use a roundabout. Because the functional area of a traffic signal controlled intersection is longer because of speeds and queue development, we tend to have to set the access points farther back. All our guidelines tell us, you know, that we have to be beyond the queue and outside the dilemma zone. Because in the dilemma zone, the driver's only focused on, you know, is the light amber, red, you know, green, they're not looking at who's coming into that area. And so we separate conflicts by pushing access away from traffic signals. So that's good news. Developers like roundabouts because they can move access closer to the intersection. The second talking point is when we use roundabouts in this video example, even if we need to restrict access to limit left turns, and that's often the low priority, you know, high risk movements are the left turns, the U-turn at the roundabout provides the opportunity. So if the driver is coming out of this development, they can't make a left turn, right? They can't go across the median. So they come through the roundabout and make the U-turn to go back in the direction to the left. So that's a safer version. It's a little bit out of their way, but we really like the idea of closely spaced roundabouts, because if queuing's low to begin with, we can load up access and have as I mentioned, we tracked the investment in this community. It was about $15 million after the roundabouts. I've studied communities in Colorado and elsewhere where they've documented the tax base increase owing to conversions of corridors, where they took, you know, 3, 4, 5 intersections, converted them to roundabouts, the tax base improved because access improved, the ability to accommodate the driveway traffic improved, and safety improved. So it became a sustainable community because of that. So it's pretty good news on the development front. Yeah.
Thank you. I'll come back later.
Alderman Peterson.
Okay. I guess this question is to us locally. How many accidents do we have in the city of Franklin historically, and how many deaths, you know, based on traffic accidents and everything? That was one of the things that was mentioned here, but I don't mean for you to answer it right now, but I'm just saying I don't think of us having a lot of traffic fatalities, thank you, a lot of fatalities. So
fatalities is a low number. We do have, when we try to look every year at accidents at our major intersections, so we can look back at the last time we've done
thank
that
you
and see if we can provide that to you.
And that is definitely something that I would be interested in. And also whenever we were looking at some examples here, I didn't necessarily see an example that we have right now. Whenever you were showing the distance to try to get across, I guess Liberty, to have a pedestrian crossing there. As far as I know, there aren't any sidewalks out there, so I don't know that we would have an example.
We'll find that slide near the end of the presentation.
Yeah. There. Okay. Are there sidewalks down the? Down to the. Okay. Okay. Okay.
A little bit.
I don't guess I've ever seen anybody.
Okay.
I don't guess I've seen anybody walking across there.
Yeah. So this diagram shows the.
Please, we can't hear up here if y'all are chattering. So go ahead and make a comment.
Thank you. We are definitely talking about two lanes in these. We're not just talking about a one lane. And I think I had asked sometime before, what was our traffic count there? And somebody may have sent that to me earlier, but I did not have time to go back and check on that, because one of the concerns that I've heard is there's so much more, I guess it would it be north-south, coming down Mallory and going to South Royal Oaks than it is going across Liberty. And I wondered what a difference it made if you had a large number, the great majority of the traffic was going kind of, as I say, one direction, as opposed to having it equal between the north, south, and the east, west.
Yeah, that's a great question. Is, you know, do roundabouts work well when there's a dominant flow?
Yes.
And the answer is no, not so well. So in an intersection like Mallory Liberty, you've got balanced flows. There's, you know, heavy directional from all directions. And so in the peak hour, and you saw from some of the video, traffic's coming from all directions. It creates gaps for the other entries when there's traffic in the circle that impedes one entry. It lets another entry just downstream get in. And if we could, you could flip to the video. It's kind of hard to describe, but sort of a dynamic situation where if there's a little bit of impedance in the circle, it helps drivers, allows drivers to get in from other directions. So having balanced traffic, you know, 50-50 from directional, 50-60, but when it gets up to about 90-10, you start to see the arterial dominate the intersection flow, and drivers mm-hmm. sometimes won't yield mm-hmm. if it's a 90-10 split.
That's one of the problems we ran into at McEwen and Cool Springs, and the reason we've moved forward with the additional turn lanes, and one of those learning experiences that we've had there, mm-hmm. but we're now mm-hmm. correcting that.
And do we have roundabouts here that would have the same amount of that would have the same amount of traffic that this particular site has?
In Franklin, not that I'm aware of. No, but in Middle Tennessee, yes, there are definitely roundabouts.
Okay, so some of the questions that I'd like to have is some examples that we could look at, at some other places.
And a couple couple of examples I would point you to is the newer roundabout on Korean Veterans Boulevard and 8th Avenue in downtown Nashville near the Music City Center. Mm-hmm. That's pretty compared. It's got pretty high traffic volumes there.
It's a huge volume.
And if you want, we couldn't get the exact volumes. We're working on this to get them from Murfreesboro, but there's several multi-lane roundabouts very close together in the middle of Middle Tennessee State University's campus mm-hmm. that are there too. So they've got fairly high volumes because they're all dual-lane roundabouts.
Okay. Thank you.
I've got Alderman Martin, and I'll go to you if that's okay, Alderman.
Well, my questions have changed. I guess I don't understand the difference between a roundabout and a traffic circle. They both go around something.
They do, but the modern roundabout's more compact. It's a smaller circle.
And that the roundabout is smaller than the square, than our square.
Correct.
Because, you know, people don't know how to use this either.
Well, and the larger circle is going to promote higher speeds. And it sometimes has uncertain priority rules. The drivers don't know whether they're supposed to yield to entering traffic or traffic entering is supposed to yield to circulating. The modern roundabout brings that together and says, if you're in the circle, you have the right of way. Speeds are lower.
If you're in the circle, you have the right of way.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yeah,
that's the way it's supposed to be. Yes.
Yeah.
But I don't, well, never mind.
Have you ever driven around it, Alderman Martin?
What?
Have you ever driven around it?
Every day.
Yeah, and we do know here to yield to the people, to the vehicles. We do yield to pedestrians because we have the crosswalk signs there. But also, I think people do understand that they have to yield to the vehicles that are in.
Some people do.
Oh, I'd say... 90% of them do, or they're going to get, somebody's going to just go in front of them anyway.
Some of your big differences there are really the lack of the splitter island we talked about. It's just painted striping on the ground. You have all single lane entries, but you have dual lanes in the middle of the circle, which people really don't know what to do with. Well, most people just try to back up in that outside lane, and the inside lane's unused because you don't really have a need for it, to be honest with you. You've also got parking off the square. This is where you really get into the public square or a traffic circle versus a roundabout.
Alderman Blanton.
Well, and I think the square is treated almost like a four-way stop. I mean, that's how people use it. I was just going to piggyback on what Miss Ann said, and I saw some heads nodding and shaking. As it pertains to the Royal Oaks, Mallory Lane, Liberty Pike, because I know it changes right there, I do live in Andover, so I see the nods and the shakes, and I have the same reservations. I don't know that today that is a balanced intersection. I think that it will be as the development continues down Liberty Pike. But right now, coming from Columbia State, what is that? Coming west, it is tremendously lower than the traffic going towards Columbia State. The same thing I can say that there's a tremendous amount more traffic coming north than there is south at peak and at any time during the day. So it's obviously this has been voted on. For all of you guys who think that we can change it, it's been voted on. I voted against it, but this education is great. I've learned quite a bit, but I just think education is going to be our biggest hurdle, especially when you have this 150-year-old beast right outside the door. Mm-hmm. That's already conditioned all the locals to think that's how you use. So your job's cut out for you. But I disagree. It's a balanced intersection. So I do think it's going to take some time before it gets used to its full intention.
Yeah, and as far as it being exactly balanced, no. But I will say one of the things we looked at was early on we wanted to look at those traffic numbers and make sure that it would work and not make the same mistake that we made at McEwen and Cool Springs. And that's one of the reasons why they came back with the recommendation for the right turn bypass lane. And so we made sure to study that very closely before we even presented that option to the board.
And the roundabout question, I think I know, in front of Andover is going to be single lane, not double, right?
It'll be single, right? It'll be single, but able to accommodate.
Honestly, we haven't decided yet. We can make it double. on Liberty Pike. Obviously, it would not be double all the way around. So a lot of times what you'll see with roundabouts is you'll see double lanes in some directions and you'll see single lanes in some directions.
Because there's really only 3 points of entry.
That's right. So you would very likely see what we've looked at right now, and this will change during design inevitably, is a single lane coming from the west to the east, so heading back towards...
Hold on, I got to stop in my head, go west to east.
Matt Hatcher to Mallory.
Okay.
And then we're looking at whether we're going to do two lanes or one lane coming from Mallory to Matt Hatcher. We haven't decided that yet. And then coming out of Stanwyck will be a single lane. So that side of the roundabout will have a single lane coming out.
How many of you all live in Andover here? So you know turning left is like already like ridiculous. At the first iteration, they had concrete all the way in our left turning lane. It's like, that's not going to work. So we got a roundabout instead. So I do think, and I'll close up, and I do have to leave early, but education is going to be the biggest hurdle here.
Could I just get some clarification? Are you familiar with Andover at this point?
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, Stanwyck, yeah.
And yep. Alderman Blanton's comment that it's near to impossible to get out of there now.
Yeah.
But how does the roundabout affect that?
Well, what's the peak direction in the morning? Eastbound?
Probably east.
Eastbound.
Yeah,
right.
Towards the high school.
So southbound has the right-of-way in the circle. That's the big difference. In the roundabout, it balances priority. So if you're southbound wanting to make a left turn, you actually have the right-of-way over eastbound traffic.
Because you've entered the roundabout.
You've entered the roundabout upstream of the dominant flow, and they have to yield to that flow. So, and we make sure that the geometry slows their speed as they're coming through. Yeah, so that's it's not often seen that way, but that's how it's gonna work.
Alderman Berger.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Mark, you talked about geometry right there. So let's talk about that, how important it is to slow down traffic entering a roundabout. Mm-hmm. So there are methods that you use to do that, correct?
Yeah, I think we're getting better at it. You know, the early designs, even Cool Springs, McEwen, mm-hmm. Music Row.
Yeah.
You know, some of those early designs, actually my predecessor worked on Music Row. And, you know, what we learned, you know, we learned a lot about trucks. And we were reacting to trucks by providing more space. So we made circles bigger. We made lanes wider. Mm-hmm. And then as we watched truck drivers and learned from them, what we learned was we didn't have to go so far with the lane widths and the size of circles. So the trend of the last few years is more compact design, which is slower when it's done right, smaller circle, and back to 12-foot lanes, 11, 12-foot lanes. And we've got designs you'll see on the ground. You can measure them, 16-foot lanes. You know, when there's that much space, the driver can enter leisurely, you know, at 25 to 35 miles per hour. And that's what we're trying to. So we're really conscious of the geometry now on speed control. And mm-hmm. That's not only helping vehicle crashes and who gets the right of way, it's the pedestrian that's benefiting.
Okay. Yeah. The key you said, if it's done right, and I think that's the key here to this roundabout. Most people don't understand that trucks do have we have the apron there for the trucks to use to go up over the apron to make the turn. And then trucks do have the right-of-way for two lanes. So when they come in, they're supposed to be in the center to use that to keep cars from being on either side of them. I think that's really important. That's part of the education. I couldn't agree more with you that education is going to be key for us in our city. Because I know Carmel, Indiana has really gone to the nth degree over the years for their education as well. Two other questions. Roads coming off of a street where it's two or three blocks down from a roundabout. Speak to that, because we were talking about platooning. And right now we have London Freedom and London Lane, and people have a hard time getting out of there now. That's south on Royal Oak, south of that roundabout. So they have a hard time getting out of there now, so how does that work?
Oh, I haven't studied it, but there's a couple of questions I would have.
And
the first one is speed a factor? Mm-hmm. Is the speed of traffic in the corridor, regardless of the volume, a factor?
Yep.
You know, above 40 miles per hour, backing out of a driveway is not an easy thing to do. So that's part of the question or the problem.
It's a street. There's a few driveways, but mostly right. Streets.
A hill
and a curve.
Well, and so you're describing something with a bit of a sight distance problem. So now we're compounding the challenge for the driver entering or exiting, mm-hmm. and the driver mm-hmm. coming over the hill and not seeing them. You know, these are common problems for highway engineers, but they make it miserable for people in the driveway. The volume question is something we've been looking for evidence. You know, roundabouts don't platoon traffic. They tend to discharge, and you saw the video, somewhat random. So you'd think, well, the traffic will just continue to arrive in the mid-block, mm-hmm. and I'll never have a gap. But it's the same amount of traffic as you would have if you'd had a traffic signal. It's just being spread out over the hour or over the time period. So the driver that's trying to get out of their driveway might think that they're not going to have as many gaps. We're looking for that evidence. We think that might be a problem, but we're not finding it. So mm-hmm. It's a quandary. I would expect what people perceive is that, well, if there's no platooning, then traffic just continues to flow, then I'm not going to be able to get out of my driveway. And everywhere we've looked for evidence of that, we're not finding it.
Yeah, and
driveways anywhere here.
No, but I mean, in a general sense, you know, having driveways on an arterial road, and traffic passing it at 35 to 50 miles per hour, that's going to be a difficult movement to begin with. But the volume of traffic can compound that. We dealt with this issue in other states where developers didn't want the roundabouts because they said there'll never be a gap in traffic. And we went ahead and built the roundabouts, and there are gaps, and we're not seeing what we thought we were going to get. Mm-hmm. It's a sort of a counterintuitive thing.
So your research is showing that that's actually not happening as you thought it would.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. And then, so I do think when you're designing and working with our team, Paul and Jonathan, I would ask that we seriously look at that and see if there's any other measures we need to put in downstream, down road, to address those issues. Then I want to talk about school, and I want to talk about raised crosswalks with RFBs, rapidly flashing beacons, or I think you said rectangular rapid flashing beacons, but how they can be used to flash when a student or a person or someone's coming up, and they can activate that. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, we teach people to hold their hand up, because those things going hand in hand make it much safer.
Sure.
So I want to speak a little bit to that. I want to speak also to the refuge center in the middle, which I think is a wise thing to do in that area with the high school. So can you speak to that a little bit more, Mark?
Sure. I mentioned that there are a number of things in the toolbox,
yeah.
and the reason to pull them out of the toolbox is generally to react to a problem. You know, most roundabouts that are well designed, we haven't had to apply things like raised crosswalks or additional measures, and it's best not to if you don't have to. They cost, they need to be maintained, and they can present this risk where the pedestrian thinks they're safer when in fact that's not the case. The raised crosswalk is a little bit of a different thing. And in Europe, in England, Australia, and in New Zealand, Sweden, in fact, as well, they're having success adding raised crosswalks back to roundabouts that have poor geometry.
Oh.
And that's because they never had speed control to begin with, and it's a single ramp up and a flat top and then a gentle departure. So we call it the one bump speed hump, and mm-hmm. It mitigates the speed where there isn't geometric speed control.
Mm-hmm.
It also elevates the pedestrian. So in the U.S., the early research, I mean, we've only been starting to use raised crosswalks for about 2 years now, and Federal Highways did a research study. It's called NCHRP 834, and it's channelized intersections, not just roundabouts, and it's the crossing dilemma at channelized intersections and roundabouts for sighted and unsighted pedestrians. And they found that when they coupled the raised crosswalk with the push-button flashing beacon, that there was less delay than at traffic signals for the blind pedestrian and fewer interventions, times when the pedestrian has to be pulled out of the crosswalk, because drivers recognize the pedestrian's elevated, The crosswalk is slower. They can't mm-hmm. cross it at speed, so they anticipate that and yield more frequently than in an untreated crosswalk. So we're seeing promise with them as a countermeasure, but some agencies are saying, well, we want to start out with them. And I can't prescribe that. I think that becomes a bit of a policy decision, because if you do one, then you might feel you have to do them all, when in fact it's a tool in the toolbox that you generally apply when something isn't working.
Well, I would ask that you talk with our team and talk, since we have a school right here, mm-hmm. that may lend itself to actually doing the raised crosswalk with the rapid flashing beacon. But as you said, good geometry, good design is really important. So when you're working on the design and when you're working with our team, will you all have that in-depth discussion about that? And also be in contact with some of our contact at the schools as well, mm-hmm. so that we make the best decision here, because I think that's really important that we do. And yes,
John. Don't ultimately add them in for whatever reason. We determine the counts aren't high enough for pedestrians. One of the things we're doing at McEwen now is we're installing the drainage infrastructure to allow them to be installed in the future whenever that Avalon Square develops. Because right now there's really not a heavy pedestrian count at that roundabout per se.
Not heavy.
But in the future there may be. So we've actually designed that and set that up in such a way where they can be added at a later date without a major construction project.
Mm-hmm. Well, we do have pedestrians here, but you're right. It's going to increase over there, which we not need to do. I think that's all I wanted to say. I know in McKay's Mill we have two neighborhood circles. We don't have roundabouts. We have two neighborhood circles. And then, of course, the roundabout at McEwen. And I think that was designed before best practices actually went into, before the best practices that we have now today, I think. And you're seeing this all over.
Sure, sure.
And you're...
Yeah, I spend part of my time fixing roundabouts.
Yeah. All right, thank you so much.
I'm going to go back to Alderman Peterson and Alderman Speedy. Are you? You don't have another comment? Okay, Alderman Speedy.
Sure, I was going to say a lot of the questions and concerns that I've received so far have been majority of parents of Centennial students and Williamson County Schools, Centennial, reaching out. And I believe maybe Mark Samuels might be here tonight, but I do think that's going to be key. Great. The education piece, and the good thing is, you know, everyone going to Centennial will be 14, or at least 13 going on 14 as a freshman, so you don't have to worry about the under 12 age.
Yeah.
And it's encouraging, I guess. My daughter will miss the maybe the in-school education on the gym floor by a year, but that's encouraging. And I do think we really need to work with the school system on the education piece. And then maybe just piggybacking on Brandy too about, you know, how we got here. We picked this design, and you know, one was because of just the engineering level of service, looking at it 2030, 2040, and also just the limited amount of land that we really do have at that intersection. You know, people forget that Vieira, Cool Springs, we're going to be in these people's backyard if we put seven lanes in through there. And then my last comment would be, I liked your comment about the cities that attacked top down, that went after their worst intersection. So I'd be curious to have you guys look at maybe an eight-lane undivided piece of property that is a tough one, just to see, is this something like this a solution from Mallory to the interstate? I mean, mm-hmm. you mentioned the commercial activity. I think that's always been a concern, right? Yeah. If we change that, how do we do that? Mm-hmm. How do we divide that? So.
Yeah, good comments.
Okay. I've got a few citizen comments, and I'm going to give them 2 minutes apiece. And I would really ask that they not get down in the weeds, and really, if they're kind of general questions that haven't been answered, feel free to pose those. So I've got Julie Picorni and Jenny Biddick and Nathan Lake. So if y'all come on up and bring that to me. And Shannon Gardner and Charlene Kimmel. So y'all line up and we'll be timing you. So, and it's okay to say I like what the other person said. And
right, right. No, my question and comment has changed drastically since
okay.
we started this. So
go ahead and say your name.
Okay, so my name is Julie Picorni. And after I listened to this, I am all in on this. This sounds like a great idea. But I do think that the education part is really the biggest hurdle that we need to overcome. But my question specifically is, can we talk about the geometry of the McEwen Cool Springs and what... How is that considered to be? Is that considered to be bad geometry there, or?
Well, I'm gonna let staff give a quick overview of that, mm-hmm. but you know, we don't want to be in the weeds. This is specific
right.
to trying to understand roundabouts. But go ahead.
So with the McEwen and Cool Springs roundabout, it was designed back in 2005, 2006 mm-hmm. with the initial guidance from the FHWA. And everybody knows we've gone through several iterations with minor modifications, and now we're doing a major modification to it. When we first built that roundabout, there was nothing in the area.
Right.
The counts on McEwen Drive were 1,300 cars a day.
Right.
There, you know, that's 13,000 now.
Right.
There were no cars on Oxford Glen. Obviously, the McEwen 3 and a 4 right. lane didn't exist. So inadvertently, we actually taught people really bad habits with that roundabout.
Right, right.
So when we initially built it back in 2007, it was just a north-south through movement with a circle in the middle. And when they striped it, it's actually really interesting if you go back on Google Earth or Google Maps and look. They striped it with just kind of not even a curved line. It was just two straight lines.
Mm-hmm.
And we taught people really bad habits because they just straddled the line and drove straight through it.
Right, right.
Instead of choosing a lane. So that's what we're seeing now.
Mm-hmm.
And in full disclosure, that's one of our higher accident intersections.
Right.
It's not an injury accident intersection, which is exactly what Mark said,
mm-hmm.
but it does have incidents there that cause property damage.
Right.
And what we're seeing there, really, it's either a failure to yield because people don't understand to yield to both lanes,
mm-hmm.
or they don't understand which lane that they're supposed to be in, and they try to change lanes in the roundabout,
right.
which is failure to maintain lanes.
Right.
So most of it's driver error.
Right.
But what we see there with the geometry and the entry, it doesn't really have any what we would call deflection angles on the entry that
mm-hmm.
helps physically slow drivers
right.
down
that is
on
what
entry.
My concern is. Yes.
Not only that, but coming down from the McEwen Hill, it's also a hill, so they're already going faster.
Right.
So some of the changes we're implementing now are to bring those up to more modern standards and to actually skew those entries to slow traffic down.
Okay. That was really my question. Is it going to be slowed in a more efficient way than it is at the other circle? Because, okay, that's it. Thank you.
Hello. My name's Jenny Biddick. I live in Eagles Glen, which is just down from Andover. My question is kind of twofold. I was not here a year ago when all this came about. So for me, it's more about educating myself a little bit. Going back to Eagles Glen used to have a rear entrance, Jordan Road. And the city came to us and we blocked Jordan Road from being the thoroughfare that it was because we didn't want our subdivision to be the cut through for people to go from Jordan to Liberty Pike. So trying to steer traffic away. So my question is, we have hard times getting out of our subdivision in the mornings and at night, just kind of depending on the time of day. Why the roundabouts were decided for Liberty and Mallory versus, say, Liberty and Carruthers in trying to steer traffic away, will this encourage more traffic to come, especially if there's a wreck on 65, where I've seen where there's a wreck on 65, so they get off on Cool Springs to try to get back on 65. Will this encourage more traffic to go that way if there is a wreck? And B, if there is the roundabout, will people start saying, hey, we'll go that route versus this route? And if that's the case, why that Liberty and Mallory would pick versus, say, Carruthers and Liberty trying to move traffic away? Thank you. That's just my question.
Yeah, I think that's a good question. I'll leave that with staff to study, if that's okay, because we're just trying to address some concerns here.
Right. Well, that's my concern.
Sure,
is,
and we appreciate that.
Thank you.
I mean, the quick answer is we were projecting a failure at this intersection, so we needed to make improvements at this intersection, and this is the path that was identified as the most effective solution.
Correct. We're rebuilding
anyway. We needed to address this intersection, And we looked at, yeah, yeah, because of the project, the performance now and the projected failure in the future. So.
If we were building Milligan today, we would evaluate both solutions for that as well.
Yeah.
But, okay, so my question is, could there be a possibility of that down the road, where there would be another situation with help relieve traffic from our end and move it to Carruthers, and where it's more commercial and less residential?
The possibility is always there.
Yeah, we always look at things as they project out.
I believe at any intersection, anytime we do a capital upgrade, we need to look at all options, all tools in the toolbox as we move forward.
Hi, I'm Shannon Gardner. I actually live in Cheswick Farm. And so one of my concerns, if you guys are familiar with we come out Liberty Hills. So my concern is we struggle to turn left out of our neighborhood going towards Centennial because we have a turn lane, turning left into Liberty Hills. So that's one of my concerns, and how is a roundabout at Stanwyck and at the Mallory intersection, how is that going to impact us and our ability to get out? Because I do worry about the constant flow, and I know we've talked about that, you know, there's the stoppage and all of that, but I guess, again, maybe it's education, but I feel like we're gonna have a harder time getting out because there won't be that stop. So that's my first question.
Okay. Thank you.
And so do you want me to show you kind of where I'm turning out of in my question? So we turn, we would be turning left here out this way, mm-hmm. and there's a left turn lane into this neighborhood, and then in the opposite, these people trying to turn left, there's a left turn lane coming into their neighborhood. So we don't have, whereas Eagles Glen, they don't have that turn lane coming into their neighborhood, so we don't have any stoppage. So that's my concern. And then my other one is do you foresee additional improvements at our interchange, at our entrance and exit to our neighborhood? I don't live in the little cluster of five or six houses, but I feel like they're gonna have the same issue in a couple years that Andover has. And then I feel like it's just going to continue to move down toward Mac Hatcher. So kind of trying to figure out how that's all going to flow in the future. And then the construction process, how long is it gonna take? What's it gonna look like? Is it gonna completely shut down that intersection? Doggone it.
Well, I think you're getting down. I appreciate your points, and I think they're good points. And, you know, this hadn't even been designed yet.
Right.
So they're going to be looking at this entire corridor, and they're not going to be ignoring your comments. They're sure. taking your comments down tonight. There may not be a specific answer. They may. So anyway, thanks for your comments.
Yep. And also, there's less than 1% of the population here, so when we're talking about educating our public, this was a public forum to educate us, mm-hmm. and there's about 80,000 residents, and there's less than 1% here. Mm-hmm. So I'm very concerned about the education mm-hmm. process.
It would be an effort.
Yeah.
Mr. Mayor.
I think we're being recorded, aren't we?
Yes, I just want to remind everybody that we are recording this. It will be available. Mm-hmm.
Charlene Kimmel, and I live in Royal Oaks. And I want to explain a little bit better for Mr. Mark here about the situation that we were talking about earlier. On Royal Oaks Boulevard going south, our subdivision of 300 and some houses uses London Lane as a major exit because we've gotten cut off at the other exits we used to have to get out. So the problem is not that there's any driveways there. It's that you sit there on London Lane waiting for a gap right now, because just south of us, less than, I would say, 25 yards, is a signal, a light signal. And then right now, down here at this intersection, there's a signal. So you have to wait until the traffic stops north and south to be able to turn left. The problem is that with the roundabout, you're going to have a gap, but it'll allow you to go right, not left, because you can't tell what's going to be happening with the light at Lakeview, whether or not you're going to be able to turn left. And right now, we are only a two-lane road. As I understand it, it's going to be a four-lane road going over that big hill and then coming in front of us. So we are in effect going to have to turn left out of our subdivision to go towards north, towards Cool Springs, against three lanes of traffic, three other lanes of traffic.
We're not doing that.
So that's what I'm just saying. Yeah. When you're looking at what's going to be happening, this is a major problem for us. Mm-hmm. The only other ways that we can get out of our subdivision right now is to go west. We have to go west on Jordan, or we have to go south to almost Liberty, take a right on, what's that called, Sheffield, go down to Glen Oaks and turn. Mm-hmm. You have no idea. It's becoming a major problem. And I just wish that you all would look at that, how that's going to be, mm-hmm. with going, with having the signalization at McEwen, and then another signal down at Lakeview. It's
and,
not going to be pretty.
To help you understand just a little bit, we're not four-laning Royal Oaks at this time.
At this time, no. But aren't those in the plans? Yes.
It's on the plan.
It's not funded.
It's not
funded. I know it's
not funded.
It's on
the plans, but it's not in the 10-year.
What you do now is going to impact down the line, and I'm just saying, it's fine, we can find a gap to get out to go south, but we won't be able to find one to go north.
Okay, we're gonna wind up with Mr. Lake now.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Nathan Lake, living in Andover. This has been a really good meeting, very informative. In fact, 8 of my questions were answered right off the bat. It was really good. So since we're dealing with the procedures of a roundabout, the question I have right now is, when there's an accident in the roundabout, what are people supposed to do with their vehicles to not stop traffic, especially in this particular intersection? The other question I did have was kind of in the weeds type of deal, and actually I might get with you guys afterwards on this. But that's and the impact on Liberty Hills was already discussed. So that was the main thing, is can we talk about the procedure of an accident?
Well, I started out saying that collisions are less frequent at roundabouts, so that's one good thing about having to deal with a collision when it does occur. The fact that it's a multi-lane condition, that there's space for two vehicles, that the fact that there's space for excuse me, for two vehicles means that the driver can pull to the left or to the right. We've seen police officers use the truck apron, and they'll set up there. Because they're fender benders, they typically don't stay for very long, and the policeman will sometimes move them through to the exit and off to the right-hand side and let the traffic continue to circulate. You know, it requires a bit of education for law enforcement to know how and where to put the drivers. But typically, it doesn't come up as a major issue that affects the design. You know, we don't have to provide additional pullouts for drivers and that kind of thing. So.
Just one quick comment that, as you said, part of the whole thing is education, and it is also education for our police department as well. And if it's conducive for them to pull people up on the apron and do those things, I think that our chief would be very amenable to making sure that we put that as part of the education.
You got one quick thought?
Just one thought. Please send us the thing that you showed today. Mm-hmm. We did not have it beforehand. Thank you.
Okay.
We'll post it on the.
It is up. It is uploaded now. Yes.
It's uploaded now.
So it's uploaded.
It was uploaded at the beginning. Yep.
Okay. Okay. I looked this afternoon.
Yeah. We were still editing it.
Okay.
We didn't want to cause more confusion by putting it up there too early.
Yeah, it's okay.
Okay.
So you're getting the most current information possible.
Thanks for coming.
I just want to say one more thing. We will be having, there will be more meetings available in the future as the design gets done and those things, I'm sure.
Oh, absolutely.
So I just want to make sure everybody knows that this isn't one and done. we'll be, and then make sure you check our website And we have areas on our website that will have this specific project on there, so you can check the status of that and when meetings are scheduled as well. I don't know, Jonathan, did you have anything to add?
One of the things I'd say, kind of unique to what we're doing, and while this is general information, but with the roundabout, because that's we've had questions about that, and there's different ideas, different thoughts. One of the things that's unique to the Liberty Mallory project is one of the first projects we've actually brought in, like a Mark Linters. It's a peer consultant review. So Volkert's doing the design. Mark, with his background, is actually here to help guide us in some of those nuances that we need to address and things that we may not think about or our designer may not think about. We're having that second set of eyes, who's considered an expert in the field, look at that. So that's something that's a little different and unique about how we're doing this project versus how we've done many other projects.
Very helpful.
Last comment,
Alderman? Well, yeah, just one last comment. It's just that being in the community the last few months, it's very important that I ran across a lot of people in this area who was concerned about this upcoming roundabout without any discussion or education or whatever. I think what I have learned today is that we really need to make sure we're bringing in our community better when we're doing these particular roundabouts, not just a regular light. But I think we have some great opportunities here. I think the idea of roundabouts are very good. We just need to educate people. And I'm so glad to hear some positives tonight that, hey, I'm not against roundabouts. I just need to know more about them. Teach me. Let's teach our kids. So that's, I think, what we need to do in the future. Thank you all so much for coming out.
Have a good night.